Welcome to Tracks to Success, brought to you by Presentation Partners. This is the podcast that brings you inspiring people and their inspiring stories. How did they find their way to the top, and how can their path help you do the same? Here's your host, network broadcaster, executive, and entrepreneur, Kraig Kann.
Right now, on this edition of Tracks to Success, you'll hear from one of the rising stars in stand-up comedy, a one-time salesman in the packaging industry who wasn't laughing when it didn't work out and turned his focus to making others have a good time and a great laugh. His path to the stage holding a microphone is unique, and it didn't come early. In fact, now he's just hitting his prime. He went from house MC to the main attraction in short order. He's found his way to a stint on the set with David Letterman. He's been on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. And he's now crisscrossing the country and other countries too, showcasing his quick wit, hilarious takes on family and marriage, and topics well beyond, in front of packed houses and arenas like Madison Square Garden. So how does a guy with a wife and young children flip the script on a career midstream? And what's his definition of the perfect show? His name is Pat McGann, the pride of Chicago and coming to a city near you. His inspiring story and this edition of Tracks to Success starts now.
Folks, my next guest is a comedian coming to us from Chicago. Please welcome Pat McGann.
Well, Pat, I saw you in Vegas, liked it so much. We saw you in Chicago, so I've been following you ever since. Just want to say thank you very much right up front for some time, and welcome to Tracks to Success. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me, Kraig. I appreciate it, man.
Man, this is good. This is either going to be the easiest interview conversation I have ever done with this podcast or the most difficult. To be perfectly honest, I have no idea what direction it's going to go, because you're a comedian. You could one-up me on like everything I could ask you.
No. I mean, we could just have a conversation. I don't have to try and be on. Well, this is going to be great, man.
Great question right there. Do you feel like you always have to be on?
I do not. No, not at all. I don't feel that way. I am annoyed by people that are always on. I think that I just try and be myself. Like if I can say something funny, I will, but I'm not like, you know, because you hear that a ton. If you're introduced to someone as a comic or they know that you're a stand-up, when you talk to them, uh-huh. I always hear all the time, like, oh, you don't seem funny. You're not funny in real life. And I think I am probably less funny off stage than I used to be, because I kind of feed that beast by doing live shows. I mean, I do love to get laughs, but I don't necessarily need to be getting laughs all the time off stage, where I think I kind of used to be funnier off stage.
Yeah, that makes sense. So let's start with this then. Pretend this podcast is actually a late night program that I'm hosting. Okay. I'm at my, you know, little desk in this Hollywood studio or New York City studio. I'm 10 seconds away from introducing you. Okay. You're standing backstage thinking what exactly?
Well, I have had the opportunity to do a couple of those shows. So I did Letterman and Colbert. And when you're about to go out live, like to do a set, stand-up set, it's a little nerve-wracking. Like you're definitely in your head a little bit. I think the more you do it, the more comfortable you are. But I think I would just be gearing up, kind of like when you're waiting in the tunnel to go out there to play like a basketball game or, you know, get out onto the field for a big game. You're amped up and you're focused and kind of don't want anybody in your ear, you know?
Right. So do you have a warm-up routine? Do you walk around practicing jokes? I mean, I public speak and I have a little warm-up routine. I like have this little talk with myself, you know, nobody ever sees it. I go into a hallway or into a bathroom and I do like 30 seconds and I tell myself some stuff. What do you do? Do you meditate? Do you sit still? Tell everybody to leave you alone? What do you do?
just vocal exercises, you know, a lot of bumblebee, bumblebee. No, I'm kidding. Just I just kind of pace, think about what I'm going to do, and try and really, like, get into the moment.
Uh-huh.
And just be aware of the situation. Be ready to deliver the material. And because, you know, when you're doing a late night set, that's a set you've done over and over and over. But you want to recreate the spontaneity that really selling the fact that you haven't said this 1,000 times or whatever, however many times, right? I mean, yeah. You want it to seem in the moment. And that's just, I think, what you strive for.
All right, I want to ask you about Colbert and Letterman, and we'll do that in just a little bit. But you're introduced as Chicago's own, right? Does the city actually claim you? I mean, are they, like, really proud of you?
You know, I have a lot of support here in Chicago. I live in the city, and I live in a part of the city that's very working class. It's the south side of Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of police, firemen, teachers. And I think that they have embraced me. One of the things that I did when I started out was I would do, like, Catholic parishes, grade schools, like fundraisers.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of what this neighborhood is. It's a bunch of different parishes. And I started doing comedy nights at those parishes. And then those people, when I wasn't really doing that anymore, those people would come see me at Zanies Comedy Club. And I was building, you know, some followers from doing shows at Zanies. And then I was doing those parish shows, started doing them in the suburbs. So I've done a lot around the Chicago area. So I think they are starting to claim me. It's a really big city. There's, I really need to try and attract more people here in Chicago. I just got a nice piece in the Chicago Tribune yesterday in the arts and entertainment section for these pop-up shows I'm doing in my living room. So that felt good that they invited me to, you know, they want to come to my house and cover what I'm doing. And then I was on WGN Morning News here in Chicago, which is our biggest like morning news show, which really moved the needle. And man, you could tell people are locked down because this morning news show, I've done it. I'll do it like maybe twice a year. And I always pick up a bunch of followers, maybe like 40, 50, 60. The other day I did a hit in the morning and I got like 600.
That's because everybody's at home.
I know. It's a good crazy time to engage.
So I'm a Chicago guy. I don't know if when we chatted briefly after one of those shows, if I ever told you that. West suburbs, grew up in LaGrange, Western Springs area. I was the kid that knew exactly what I wanted to be when I grew up, right? I wanted to be a sportscaster. And I got that.
Awesome.
But then that's changed. Funny. So what's your story as a little kid? What did you want to be? Where did you grow up? All that stuff.
I grew up in Beverly, West Beverly,
mm-hmm.
Morgan Park area. And I wanted to be, you know, I love basketball and baseball. So my first thing I probably wanted to be was that, like a professional athlete, which you start to realize is not going to happen, you know, probably around high school. And from there, I was kind of a little lost, you know. I thought about law school because that's what my dad did. I went to college in Ohio, University of Dayton, and ended up majoring in history. Thought maybe I could teach history and coach basketball. And then I realized that I probably wanted to make a little bit more money. So I got into sales, which was like, I just ended up there. People would just say, oh, you'd be good at sales. So I like talking to people and I like socializing, and I just ended up in sales. And I was doing that for 10, 11 years. I didn't start stand up till I was like 31.
Yeah.
So I'm a latecomer. I started really late. But I always had this in the back of my mind. I always liked writing but I never liked performing. I was never in a play or on a stage. So that was the biggest leap for me to try that, to actually get up in front of people.
You got to be really bummed, by the way. You got to be really bummed that Dayton didn't get its chance as a number one seed in March Madness, by the way. That's the only thing I'm going to ask you about college athletics.
Dude, I was perspective, right? And because everyone is dealing with this thing. But when it first hit, that was definitely one of the first thoughts in all my, like, UD buddies and my family. My dad went to Dayton. My sisters went to Dayton. So we were all crushed by that. That was the most magical year they've ever had.
Yep.
And the double whammy of it was, you know, Dayton in, I believe it was September, when they had that mass shooting. That city has always embraced the Flyers. That's like their pro team. They're not, right. I felt really bad for the people of Dayton.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I mean, that's always been what, you know, the play-in game or one of the early games, you know, in the NCAAs, Dayton was like a venue, you know. This time it was a team, and it was, you know, they had a great player and all that. So you just, like, of all the NCAA kids that you think about, and so many of them affected by canceling March Madness, my mind went straight to Dayton because mid-majors don't get that shot to be a number one seed and legitimately be looked at as a potential national champion or Final Four contender. I mean, it's just different. When you were that kid growing up, Beverly, wherever, and you said you like to talk to people and all that, were you a kid that held court? Because, like, now you hold court. That's kind of what you do. Did you hold court back then?
I mean, not any more than my buddies. Like, we were always out running around, and we were all smartasses. Everybody was trying to crack the other guy up, you know? We weren't necessarily class clowns or punks, but we were, like, the guys I ran with, we were always trying to, like, entertain each other and just be just funny. All of my friends still are. I just hang out with funny people, I think.
So you mentioned that you were in sales, packaging, right? Like, what were you selling? And how could you?
Oh, here, I could bring it right to you because I met you in Las Vegas.
Yep.
I remember at Brad Garrett Club. I used to have a ton of business in Las Vegas. That was where most of my accounts were because I sold to hotel and casinos, like the printed bags. Like, so when you go to Caesar's Palace and you go to, like, their sundry shop and they give you a Caesar's Palace bag.
Yep.
I sourced those. And then when, like, Celine Dion was the first act at the Coliseum when they built that, she was, like, the resident act. And she had a Celine Dion gift shop. So we did all the packaging for that gift shop. And then Elton John came in, and then Bette Midler came in. And I was, like, the packaging guy for all that. That's what I was doing.
Have you used that in your stand-up? Like, is that a funny bit? That could be a funny bit, couldn't it?
It might be. Maybe still too painful to revisit because I was not that good at it. I was good at inheriting accounts. I opened up a couple of accounts, and I did actually in Las Vegas too, but it started to get so competitive. And once, like, the internet blew up, it was, and people were just, it was so easy to get in touch with people, and there was no value in, like, relationships. Mm-hmm. It was like I was losing business on price everywhere. And, like, people telling me, like, can you match this quote? This is what, like, we love you. We've been working with you for years, but I got to save money. So it was just like, I got to get out of this. Mm-mm.
So who told you comedy was your thing? And when you stood up there at first, how bad were you after somebody told you this could be your thing?
You know, I started dating my wife in March of 07. That's when I met her. And I first went on stage in September of 07. And that was the, she was really, I got to give her credit. Like, I kind of confided in her, like, hey, I got these notebooks and I've been writing and I kind of think I could try stand up. Like, it took me a lot just to say that to her because I thought my thing was like, if I say this to people, they're all going to be like, why do you think you could do that? Like, you think you're funny? Like, what are you talking about? Like, but she really encouraged me. She was like, everybody is from somewhere. They're just regular people doing this. Go do it. Now, I don't know if she would tell me to do it again, today, now knowing how much I would, well, now I'm home all the time, but you know, I'm usually gone, and it's not the easiest life, especially when you got little kids. But that's how it started. Just going to open mics in Chicago. And then I was bad the first time. The light in your eye when you go on a stage, I never knew how blinding that was. So that's what I remember from my first experience, was like, I just could not see the audience. I was terrified, and I forgot 50% of what I had prepared. But I got a couple laughs. I got a couple laughs that I was like, okay, I didn't completely embarrass myself. And I love how that felt. I got a big rush out of it. It's like, I got to do it again. So I started doing it.
So then you find out, like, okay, they laughed at this, you know? They didn't laugh at this, so I'm going to shelve that. They laughed at this, so I can make that my thing. Maybe I do 5 minutes on that. Is that how it works when you're first starting out? You figure out where your kind of your lane is, if you will?
I think when you're first starting out, it's not even like your voice. Like, it's not what you're talking about. It's just getting comfortable on stage and writing jokes. Like, that probably you're not that attached to. That's how I started. What I found out through doing this and being in the world of comedy is that talking about your life is probably like the best route, you know, keeps you original, keeps you fresh. And it, like, you just become relatable in whatever way. Mm-hmm. But when I was first starting out, I was just very detached from my material. Like, I had a bit about homeschool. I had a bit about Taco Bell. And I mean, these were funny things. They were observational, but it was not really like me. Like, I think you're always trying to get to this place where you're just like so authentic up there. And I'm still not there, but that's the journey.
I think that you are there. Don't sell yourself short, because I saw you work a room not once but twice, and it's a gift, you know. It's something that not a lot of people have. At the same time, I think with the listeners that listen to this podcast, what I want them to try to maybe take from this is also just what goes in the mind of a guy who's become successful when you probably had a lot of self-doubt, right? I mean, you talk about the lights being bright and maybe losing your focus. I mean, my world in TV, when I was TV, everybody said the camera adds 10 pounds. So I'm like, all right, make sure there's only one on me, you know? Don't make sure, I don't need three of them on me. But like, you had to have some self-doubt and going, all right, I wasn't great at sales, or I didn't want to do sales. I'm trying this. What next if this doesn't work out?
Yeah, you know, I started gradually. I didn't like quit my job right away. And I kind of eased out of my commission sales job. Like, my commission just was dropping. And while my shows and schedule were kind of climbing, but I wasn't making any money. Like, I couldn't really sustain. So I eventually got laid off, and then I got another job working at a restaurant to just try and bring in some more money. And then when I, started doing the shows, like, you never don't have self-doubt. Like, I still have it. I get it. You know, I can give you an example as recently as 2 days ago. I'm doing these pop-up shows in my room or in my house during this lockdown. And I got the coverage on it, got excited about it. And I tried to, like, you know, send it out to some people in LA, and they weren't all that excited about it. And then you're like, start to creep in the back of your head, like, should I be doing these shows? Like, I just got some coverage on it, and people are giving me good feedback, but maybe, you know. And I've been rejected by every late night show. I've been rejected by festivals, by people that, you know, air specials, networks, but I've also gotten a lot of yeses along the way too, and plenty of validation.
Yeah,
but I'm constantly getting rejected and getting told no, or not right now, or maybe. That's just part of the game, you realize. And it's hard to not take it personally, because what I do is personal. This is my life that I'm sharing. So yeah, it sucks when you get that, but I think you just learn that you got to be resilient, because if you quit, you're not gonna survive.
Yeah, our greatest successes always seem to come from not in our comfort zone, but from out of our comfort zone. Like when people say, you can't do this, you're never gonna make it. And then you go, you know what? Hey, I am gonna make it. I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do that. And you keep persevering and all that. So you have made it. You talk about the yeses you got. Tell me about Letterman. What was it like to be on his show?
It was phenomenal. You know, that was the one show that I was really trying to get on. When I first started, that was like my major goal. And it took 3 years. So when I finally got it, I was the most excited I think I've ever been.
I'm usually at home doing chores. Laundry, that's my big one. And I'm married. I have to do my wife's clothes and my clothes. And I'll tell you what, that kind of ruins the moment when we mess around. I no longer tear her jeans off. I take them off. Like, I'm going to lay these out. I'm probably wear these again. Take her shirt off. What is this, linen? I'm going to have to iron this. We messed around the other night. She got a little sweaty. She's like, I'm going to get a towel. I was like, you're going to get a paper towel. I just did towels.
Definitely in the world of comedy. That's actually a lie. So I go out there and they treated me so well. You know, they fly you out there. They got the guy at the airport with your name on the sign. They bring you into Manhattan, into the city, and they put you up right around the corner from the Ed Sullivan Theater. And then just that, the Ed Sullivan Theater. Like, I'm kind of a history guy, a pop culture guy. Like, it's not lost on me that that's where the Beatles made their debut. It's that stage. You know, Elvis performed there, all of that. Like, that's cool to me. And Letterman is a legend, icon. Like, that's the guy growing up. He was the benchmark. I remember Johnny Carson. I remember my parents watching Johnny Carson, but I was so into David Letterman. So it was a thrill. I mean, it was so cool. I had like a bunch of buddies came out from Chicago. And my college roommate came out, and my parents were, of course, there, and my wife and sisters. Like, it was a moment. It was definitely a moment. So it was very cool. I was nervous. I was very nervous, and it was a blur, but it was cool.
Did he talk to you before or after? Did he say anything? And
not before. Not before. I did see, like, a few of the, you know, like Biff and Paul Schaefer, and but I did not see David Letterman until he introduced me. And even then, you don't really see him. Like, you look, I remember coming out and looking over there, and here's the first time I've seen him. Like, and I'm already nervous. Now you're performing, really, like on TV, it looks like you're further apart. He's only really like 10 feet away from you. And I could hear him laugh at a couple of the jokes. And that was, you know, you're processing that and trying to remember your next line, you know? So it was, it was cool.
How many?
I did get the chance to do it a second time, like a year and a half later, or a year later. And that time it was a difficult time in our life for personal reasons, but I was also like able to enjoy the moment more and like really take it in.
Yeah. How many times did you like rehearse for Letterman compared to Zanies or some other place around the country? I mean, I got to imagine, you know, you're going, this is my big break. And if I nail this, gosh knows. And if I don't, you know, like the pressure you might've felt.
Oh yeah. I was doing the set. It was like a 5-minute set. I was running it everywhere. So when you have that set coming up, like I remember that the date was probably like January 23rd or 4th. So once January hit, every night I was going to Zanies and doing that 5-minute set. And then I would do it somewhere else too, you know, do it at another Zanies. They have three clubs at that time. They had three clubs in the Chicagoland area. And then, you know, there's a lot of independent rooms and bar shows. And I would, you know, call those bookers or whoever's running those rooms, be like, can I pop up for 5 minutes? And I ran that set everywhere. Hmm. And I still screwed it up. I still screwed up a line in the actual taping.
In addition to hosting this podcast, Kraig leads the Kann Advisory Group, focused on elevating communication for companies and individuals. Company consulting, empowering team and individual workshops, mind-altering webinars, and Kraig's inspiring keynotes for your conference or company meeting. They're all on the menu of services. Kann Advisory helps companies clarify their message, helps professionals build and showcase their brand, and helps everyone present their best selves. So if you're the leader of a team or company looking to give your employees a game-changing one-day experience, or an individual who wants to become a speaker and presenter that gets other people talking, visit kannadvisory.com. And when you do connect, make sure to mention the Tracks to Success podcast to receive a special discount on any of the Kann Advisory services. That's kannadvisory.com. Now back to the interview.
So there's a couple topics, and I've seen you a couple of times, that you really go after. And it, you know, most comedians probably do. One of them is marriage. I mean, is that just like such an easy target? Why does everybody go there?
I think it's just if you're married, that's your life. You're a married person. So it's not like I'm railing on marriage per se. I mean, maybe it sounds like I am. I'm just airing out the BS in my relationship. I'm just like the blowing through money, the what we're doing all the time, like the kids. And it's not that it gets easy. I think it's just like you're just reporting your life experience.
Yeah. And every guy sitting next to his wife in the audience, or guy who's sitting next to his potential wife, or we could flip it, right? I mean, they're just, their minds are just spinning with you. So it's got to be just like the easiest thing to go along with.
Yeah. And I think it's just, as long as it's not like too easy, like I never would want to do like the hacky, like, my wife's so exhausting and, my boss, like all that, take my wife, that stuff. But I try and like slightly exaggerate the truth, but it has to be rooted in the truth, or it's, mm-hmm. you cannot sell it. Yeah. It's not going to be relatable.
Kids. I mean, that's another easy one because everybody can relate to that. And you've got young kids. So, some of your bits that I've seen about, the wife waiting to come home, you're watching the kids. And we all know that there's such a different dynamic between the woman watching the kids and the guy watching the kids, right?
Yeah. I do the bit about, they're always asking me when's mom going to be home. It's like, when I start paying attention to you, she's close.
Yeah.
When I don't know. When I put my phone on the counter, she's in the driveway. Let's go find out how her day was. But I try and do these bits like we went to a water park and I was like, this is a disaster. Like, but everybody's there. It's like lemmings, right? It's like we all walk off the same cliff as parents. Like we know that we shouldn't be bringing our kids out of state to play a hockey game. But we do it, even though they suck and they could be getting beat down the street. We got to take them out of state and stay in a hotel. And you want to like jump out a window, but just break your leg because it's a Hampton Inn. There's only 3 floors. Yeah, it's getting all that stuff. Just. There's so much hypocrisy around us, right? Like that's what life is. It's contradictions. It's all this. And like, that's what you're pointing out. Everything is just ridiculous.
Yeah. So one of my
cynical?
One of my favorite bits that I've seen from you is I think it's the woman over 35 with the open shoulder shirt. right? The sleeve on the shoulder. Give me that bit, would you?
The open shoulder bit, the cold shoulder, the peekaboo. It's like every woman has that now. It's like they hand them out to you. Once you turn 38, they're like, here's your open shoulder shirt. Get in line. Now get out there. Show everyone what you're working with. And now every woman's walking around. Hey, check it out. Check this out right here. Here's a part of my body I'm confident about. Like, you checking this out? Yeah, that's where the doctor gives me a shot. That's a tetanus scar right there. I love wearing those shirts. Then they start talking about their new diet that always starts tomorrow. You always catch them on their cheat day. But they're like, tomorrow, I'm starting a detox. I'm doing a cleanse. I got some apple cider vinegar and some chia seeds. I'm drinking kombucha. You want to do it with me? It's like a 10-day. It's like, no, I don't want to do it. I'm not doing it. Like, they want to, like, give up dairy. No more dairy for me. It's like, how about no more peanut butter cups till Wednesday? Why don't we give that a shot before we throw out all the milk and half and half we already paid for?
So it's easy to pick on the wives or the husbands or the in-laws, right, or the kids. Do your kids think you're funny? I mean, my kids never watched me on TV. They'd, like, blow that off, you know? Yeah, whatever. Do they think you're funny?
My daughter does. My daughter is 8, and she doesn't get all the jokes, but, like, she get, like, they think I'm funny in the house. Like, I'll do goofy stuff or say things. They don't get a lot of it. But I do think my daughter is, like, more, like, on the same page. So my boys are just kind of, like, you know, they're just idiots, these little dudes. They're just, like, whatever. I mean, I love – they're not idiots in that sense.
I know.
God, that sounds terrible when I said that. But they're just, like, they don't get it. They don't give a crap about me. They're just, like, chasing each other around, tackling each other. It's hilarious. It's, like – you could see it early, the difference, right? I mean, my daughter is, like, so organized and so, like, perfect. And then I got these mopes literally playing grab ass. Like, I thought grab ass was, like, just a, like, a, I don't know where that came from. I remember my coach being like that. You guys playing grab ass. My boys, I walked in, they were literally trying to grab each other's ass. Like, what the hell are you guys doing?
So when I was at Golf Channel, I would go to parties, right, with couples or friends, and everybody wants to talk about Tiger. Like, you're the cool guy. You go to this major championship. You're at the Masters. Or, hey, you went to the Ryder Cup. What was it like? Whatever. You can't escape it. When you go, everybody wants to talk about that stuff. So is that what happens, Pat? People come up and go, give it to us. And you're on stage, whether you're trying to have a drink or hang out with friends or what?
No, I mean – that's the worst when people do that. So, people I don't know sometimes will say, like, oh, you're a comic? Say something funny or be funny. You know, that whole thing.
Yeah.
It makes you, like, shrivel up. You're like, but I do, I'm a social guy. I like to be around people. But I'm not holding court by any means or trying to. But I do like to, you know, this is where you get material when you go out with people and you see things, you talk about other stuff and you hear what other people are experiencing, like, I kind of like those situations because I don't get to do them often because I'm always doing shows. So I don't get to go out and socialize with my wife and our crew. You know, my wife usually has to go to that stuff by herself. So when I'm kind of socially awkward now. I used to be better in social situations, but it's like you get out of practice.
Yeah.
You know?
I didn't even think about that. I mean, you're traveling the road, you know, shows or what? Thursday, Friday, Saturday, you know, so you're up the creek.
Yeah. I'm like, I realize how much I've been traveling the last like year and a half, 2 years. It's been insane. So it's been, you know, it's good to have a little stretch at home every now and then.
Pat McGann, comedian, is our guest on this edition of Tracks to Success. Tracks to Success is brought to you by Presentation Partners, visual storytellers passionate about connecting presenters with their audience. All right, we talked about Letterman. Give me the story about The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. That had to be fun as well.
Oh, that was another great experience. And, you know, back at the Ed Sullivan Theater, they had really changed it up. I didn't anticipate, like, the dressing rooms were on a different floor. And they redid the whole thing to make it their own, which makes sense. I just didn't really foresee that. So it was a really different experience, but awesome, you know? And you know what's cool about that show? I was so relaxed and, like, ready that, you know, my wife wasn't out there. I was a total different thing. Like, I had no family there, no friends really. So I do the set, and, or before I do the set, they had like a special John Stewart appearance on my, on my episode. So when I went out there to like get my mark, they show you like, are you going to come out here, stand on this X? I'm seeing John Stewart. I didn't expect to see him there because I saw who the guests were. And then the dressing rooms, they're all right next to each other. And I was right next to Sean Astin, which is cool, right? Mm-hmm. You're like, oh, this is Rudy. Mm. This is Mikey from Goonies. Like, those things are cool. Like, the first Letterman I did, Kevin Bacon was on.
Oh, wow.
Like, having those, like, be intersecting, crossing paths with those people, you know? So they also did something cool, which kind of worked against me, I think. But the night of the Colbert show, they had like three guests. They had the Jon Stewart pop up, and they had Carol Burnett. But Carol Burnett was not on my episode, but they taped it that night because they were airing it for like a special that she was doing like a week later. So they did like a 2-segment interview with her. So by the time I got out there, this crowd had been sitting there for close to 3 hours, which is not great. Mm-mm. For a comic. So I think that kind of like, you know, worked against me a little bit. I'm proud of the set and like the set, but just being there and like when I walked on for that set, Carol Burnett was literally walking right past me, and that was a cool moment.
All right, I'm happy to be here. Just good to be out, right? Just good to be out. Got kids at home. My wife and I have three under four. Yeah, that's how people react. Some people ask me what it's like. Here's a fast fact. 75% of the asses I wipe aren't mine. Got one in preschool, one in pre-preschool. Did you know that existed? Pre-preschool. My wife's like, he wants to go. We gotta sign him up. He wants to go to school. It's like, he wants to go to school? He doesn't know what school is. He wants to go to school? Just walk him out to the garage. Be like, here we are. Yeah. This is our first day. This is a broom right here. We're gonna learn how to sweep today. He might be gifted. That's what my wife says. Like, yeah, he was eating a crayon yesterday. A purple one. Looked like you after a glass of wine. Sometimes we'll take one. You know, I'll take one. My wife will take one, kind of divide and conquer. She took my daughter out the other night and then sends me a text. We're staying out. Thought you guys had some boy time. And just leaves me with the two little dudes. Like, really? The little guy doesn't even know he's a boy. Boy time. All right, text me when you're close so I can get rid of all the strippers and blow. Boy time, what do you do? You guys want to watch a game? Throw the ball around? Oh, no, you want to stand on that chair and flick the light switch on and off. What do you want to get into? Oh, take all the Kleenex out of the box, one by one? That's awesome. No, don't worry about it. I'll just stuff them back in there. I'm just happy to be hanging out with the fellas.
How easy is it to pick on people in the audience? Do you look for it? Do you try to target somebody and go, I'm going to have some fun with this guy tonight?
I started as a host at Zanies. So I was like the house MC. So every night we were doing 12 shows a week, and I would do a ton of crowd work. They wanted you to work the crowd, you know, start coming out being like, is anyone from out of town? Anyone celebrating anything? And I would start to lean into people a little bit. And now I only do it if they bring attention to themselves, if they're interrupting the show. They interrupt the show or they're heckling, or sometimes if I'm bored or I might be, you know, I might have tried a new bit and I'm processing like, okay, that kind of went okay. Or, you know, you're kind of thinking in real time, like that's not going to work, or that could be like enhanced, like build on that. In those moments, I might lose my footing in where I want to go next. And I might do some crowd work. Like, you know, and I only do that in the clubs, you know, when I'm opening for Sebastian and we're traveling and doing theaters and you know, these arenas, and I don't do any crowd work.
Yeah. Yeah. I, I ask that because, and I know you don't know tons about golf on the PGA Tour, but if you talk to PGA Tour players, they will tell you that on Wednesday in the Pro-Am, right, where people pay big bucks to go play with the pro and all that sort of stuff, on Wednesday, there's always that one guy who thinks he's really good and he can, like, beat the professional. And the Tour Pro loves that because they think, yeah, who's this guy? Okay, yeah, is there somebody in the crowd usually that tries to go toe-to-toe? I mean, you got a story of some guy that, like, thinks he's funnier than you?
There's definitely that guy. There is that guy. He's not at every show, but he pops up a lot. And that guy does this. That guy will try to add to your joke, yell something out that might be somewhat related to it, but never in the right direction, you know? They derail things. And then this is where that guy really sucks, is after the show, that guy comes up to you and says, "Hey, man, that was me. That was so fun tonight, man." Like, thinking that they added to the show, that they made it better.
And they ruined it for themselves. And so what's your reply to them? Hey, thanks a lot, buddy. I really appreciated you coming here. Bring five friends the next time or what?
Yeah, exactly. It's like, dude, I don't. And then you just can't even, like, pretend. You just got to be like, oh, yeah. Like, just get away.
They say when you have a good idea, write it down immediately because you never remember it the same way later. So you write your own stuff, right? I mean, you're driving around. Do you pull over and do you write down your jokes? Is that accurate for how a stand-up comedian works? Where do you do that?
I do that. I will write stuff in my phone or voice record an idea, jot, you know, just notes, like things. And then maybe, you know, revisit them later. It might be a premise or something. But I don't do it as much as I used to. And I have found that if it's really funny, you probably are not going to forget it. Mm-hmm. You might. I think you more like forget like little tags or little things that you add to jokes, but like an overall idea or theme, like you're probably going to be like, oh, I do want to sit down and flesh that idea out or start rambling about that on stage, which my process is kind of evolving too. I used to be very much write it in the notebook, trim it, have it really tight. And then I found that I wasn't sounding as conversational as I wanted to, like just having a conversation with the audience. I think that's like the goal, like that it seems like they're just talking with you, but it's a very one-sided conversation, obviously. Mm-hmm. And then, so I started just kind of like trying stuff on stage and trying to let it come out naturally.
So let's do a little quick rapid fire. Give me the night you remember as your best. Is there something that stands out? One night that you go, you kind of went back to your hotel room or you said, "Whew, man, that was amazing."
Well, I've been handed some really unbelievable opportunities by opening for Sebastian Maniscalco. And the crowds that he is getting, they're so excited to see him. I mean, they are juiced. We did four shows in Madison Square Garden that he sold out. I just did the United Center with him in November, and that was like a homecoming for me. You know, he's from here too. People were so excited. So it's like, there are so many great shows. I think that there was a night in Pittsburgh that we did. And again, I'm just his opener doing 20 minutes. So it's like, I judge these separately. I judge those shows separate from like my own shows. Mm-hmm. But we did a show in Pittsburgh, and for whatever reason, it was just like a magical night. But those happen, you know, every now and then, like not more than every now and then, like, cause those crowds are so juiced. Mm-hmm. The good ones, hopefully they're all pretty good. You know, it's the bad ones that stand out. It's sometimes you're just like, oh my God, that was brutal. They hate him. I did a show with Sebastian recently, and I think it was Poughkeepsie, New York, and we were doing six shows over the weekend. And I like those anchor down weekends where mm-hmm. we're in one city, mm-hmm. one hotel. And the first show I was like really fired up about, and they were just not into me that much. Like I kind of got them at the end, but like those are the ones that you just kind of like, you want to like take a shower after. You're just like, you just feel like deflated. Hmm.
It's interesting because, and I wouldn't have known that, you know, one great show with the same guy, right? You're traveling the same show. You're in Chicago, you're at Madison Square Garden. Amazing. And then you're in a smaller town and it's, maybe it's the community. Maybe it's the people.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah. I mean, that's the thing. Like with him, I'm not a draw like he is at all. So I'll be with him and it's like bananas. And then I'll do a club on my own in like Des Moines, Iowa on a Thursday or a Sunday night. And you know, there could be some great shows in Des Moines, Iowa, but on Sunday night, there might only be 30 people come out. Mm-hmm. And you're kind of like, oh boy, this is what I remember. This is really comedy. Like I'm so spoiled living in this like Sebastian world. And then I get these reminders of what's really out there, you know? Yeah.
So what do you do?
Like how you give me a rapid fire segment and I just answer for 30 minutes.
No, I love it. It's good. You give me the best city in the country that you've been to. Take away Chicago, take away Madison Square Garden. Best city that nobody knows about that you're like, man, I'd do comedy there every night.
Madison, Wisconsin's a great town.
That's awesome.
I love Madison, Wisconsin. I like Grand Rapids, Michigan. Like there's some great like B cities. Mm-hmm. I loved Vancouver, Canada.
Expensive city, by the way. Oh, Vancouver.
Oh, is it? Is it? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You don't want to live
there's
there.
There's so many great cities.
It's so
Austin.
Beautiful though.
Yeah.
Okay. So that part of it is all really cool. A joke bombs, and what do you do? Like, there's people that do presentations or public speaking, and they're always so fearful, right? Of, because by the way, I don't know if you know this, but number one fear among all Americans in a survey is public speaking, and number two is death, which makes me laugh because it suggests that somebody'd rather be buried 6 feet underground than be above ground talking about the life they had before they got buried. I never understand that. But your joke bombs, what do?
I think you just got to own it. Either you go right into the next thing or you call it out. Like that's always like, that's the biggest thing in public speaking. I see that. You know, I've been at the presentations or, you know, been at services where like when people get up and they don't recognize the obvious, like mm-hmm. you got to call out whatever elephant is in the room always. And that's just like an instant connector and it relaxes everyone. Cause I do a lot of corporate gigs. So I see speakers often. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they're like brought in, sometimes they're just employees of the company. And you could tell a difference when people are connecting and they're not connecting.
We're talking with Pat McGann. Pat, a few more things before I let you go. Here's the thing tied to what we were just talking about. I coach executives and teams about presentation, how to own a room and the art of connection and quick engagement, you know, how you hook people. And you can use all these different tactics, and there's a bunch of different ones. One of them is humor. But I always tell people you got to be really, really careful about this, because if you start with humor and you're not funny, you're swimming upstream. It's really difficult to get the engagement and get an audience back. So for you, I mean, you're a funny guy to begin with, but I'm guessing that the first 30 seconds for you walking up on that stage in front of people is your most critical. Is that fair?
Oh yeah. You definitely have to get off the ground early. The longer it takes to get off the ground, it's just like it gets worse. It snowballs. You got to get that first laugh. You know, because like if you don't, your average stuff becomes really bad and your great stuff becomes pretty good. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like you have to connect immediately. People do not have, this is obvious, right? People just do not have the attention span that they used to have. So the comedy audiences, usually if they don't know who you are, and most people do not know who I am, you gotta like get out there and punch them in the mouth, like immediately get their attention.
Average attention span's 8 seconds. 8 seconds. I tell people that. I go, you know, that's not a lot of time. I had a guy raise his hand in one of my seminars. He goes, I'm here to tell you 8 seconds is a lot of time. I go, really? He says, yeah. I was a professional bull rider for like 15 years. Let me tell you, 8 seconds. So everybody laughs, right? Good line by that guy. But in that, I hear you. And you were talking about trying to do things that get people. You kind of just said, people don't know you. I disagree. I know you. You're memorable to me. And I have this saying that master storytellers create legions of followers. So you got me, right? But how big is it to have a following for you? How do you try to grow that? Do you have a philosophy?
I don't really have a philosophy. I have a, and it's like probably been to my detriment a little bit. I've always thought that if I'm just a really good comic, that it will just happen. But there are so many great comics that it has not happened for in terms of huge success. Now, I say that being very happy with where I'm at in my career. And, you know, I still live in Chicago, so I haven't made the move to New York or LA. And that, you know, I can't say that, you know, I've put everything into it, simply just that alone. I never moved to New York or LA. But, now, as I feel like I'm talking about things that people are connecting to and relating with, that's how I'm getting followers. Word of mouth, doing great shows, and just putting content out there. I've realized how important social media is. When I got into this, I didn't get into it to do social media. I got into it to do stand-up comedy. And then this social media thing exploded. And then you have to pivot into that world. And that took a while as well to try and get that going. And I'm still not the best at that. So it's like I ran away from business to do this like hobby. And I'm finding out that it's just as much a business. Like this is, you know, you have to really hustle. People are out here working hard. And the most successful people that I've come across, as I've gotten to know them, they are work demons. They're obsessed. They are relentless. And that's I think, what it takes to be great.
You talked about the social media following, and I want to go back to the pop-up comedy that you did in your house during the coronavirus and everybody on lockdown. Perfect example, right? Because you put it all over Instagram, you got it on Twitter, and your kids, it's so funny because, you know, you'd walk into the room holding the microphone and the same kid, I don't know which kid it is because I haven't met your kids, but same kid screams every single time. You click off the TV. How did you come up with this whole thing? And your wife, by the way, is pretty funny.
Oh, yeah. Oh, thank you. Yeah, she is funny. So we did, I was, you know, when I got sidelined from the live shows, I was home, and after that first week, like, cause I don't go 5 days without being on stage. I was like, I just miss doing shows. So I just literally, I was like looking for things. I had posted a couple things at the beginning of the quarantine and they were fine. And then I was like, let me try this pop-up show. And then it just seemed like after I did it, that like, well, this could just be like a refillable, like it's got a beginning, middle and end. It's got like the beginning, like when I turn the TV off and they scream, like, and I always catch them off guard. Like that's a real response when they're doing that. So once I started posting those, it just kind of snowballed. And, you know, at times was like, can I do this again? Or should I do this again? Cause it gets to be a little bit exhausting, but also there were many nights I was looking forward to it. Like, hey, I got a couple good ideas for tonight and I want to tell these jokes, but
I'm sure your kids are looking forward to it too.
It's just the way I dealt with denial.
Yeah. All right. Let's get this out of the way before I ask my final question. Where can people find your stuff? Website, YouTube, maybe, obviously on the road at shows and whatnot or in Chicago, but give us your Twitter handle, your Instagram and your website.
So Twitter is at McGann Pat. Instagram is at McGann underscore Pat. And then I have a website, patmcgannconomedy.com. What's cool about this, Craig, is good timing. If people want to check out my special, I take the special that Sebastian Maniscalco actually is producing. He produced it. We shot it here in Chicago at the Vic Theater. We did a couple shows, and I got a special out of it that I'm excited for people to see. And it's going to come out, I believe, July 1st. So it might be out already, right? No, July 1st.
Not quite. Maybe.
Okay. So July 1, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be on Amazon.
Oh.
But it's going to be on a bunch of different platforms, including Apple TV. And so we're kind of working out where exactly it's going to be, but it's going to be July 1. And if you follow me on social media, you will definitely know where it is.
All right.
So I'm excited for people to see it.
This is called Tracks to Success. That's what this podcast is called. And I say inspiring people, inspiring stories. We've talked about your journey. You have a unique career and an interesting path. Biggest advice you could give to people in any walk based on your journey to being a sought after entertainer. And I do say sought after. What advice do you give people about their path?
I you know, not to sound like cliche, but if you find something that you're passionate about, whether you monetize it or not, I think it will bring you happiness. I think you can measure success a lot of different ways. Just, I think being yourself, which is so hard to do, right? Mm-hmm. To be your true self, and just put time in, whatever. I don't want to tell people to work hard because that doesn't come natural to a lot of people, but just putting time in to some passion. And again, it doesn't have to be something you monetize. I just think it brings a lot of joy doing that.
Well, you're a Chicago guy, pride of Chicago. I'm a Chicago guy, love the city, seen you at Zanies, as we talked about, saw you in Vegas. I guarantee I'm going to come find you again someplace, and everybody else should as well.
Thank you, Craig.
It's been a pleasure to have you. And to all our listeners, go find Pat McGann. Pat, be safe. Thanks so much for the time. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Craig. Take care.
In our conversation, Pat shared stories about standing in front of an audience and the goal of owning the stage, which leads me to my one last thing. If you want to be an influencer, realize that being a good to great presenter is one of the biggest gifts among great leaders in any profession. It's not just what you say to people, it's how you say it, and more importantly, how you make people feel. In my workshops, one of the key focal points is the time spent crafting your personal story, and then the opportunity to deliver it to an audience. How we connect our stories is a direct lead to how relatable you are and what people will say about you. So when you're faced with your next presentation, think about connecting with those in front of you. It's more important than the words or the information you deliver. I hope these thoughts and the things we discussed in this interview help put you on the track to success. If you have a guest you think belongs on Tracks to Success, go ahead and share it on our Twitter site, at Tracks to Success. I can't wait to hear from you. Until next time, I'm Kraig Kann. Thanks for listening.
You've been listening to Tracks to Success, brought to you by Presentation Partners, visual storytellers passionate about connecting presenters with their audience. Don't forget to subscribe to the show for more great interviews and thoughts on reaching your highest personal and professional summit. You can follow Kraig on Twitter and Instagram using the handle at Kraig Kann. And for exclusive Tracks to Success content and news about our upcoming guests, you can find Tracks to Success on Twitter. It's at Tracks to Success.